Jesus, Lord.
Thank God for His grace. Thank God for what He has already done in this place. And I expect that God's going to do some more great things for us before this weekend is over with. Amen. And I am privileged to be here with you. I appreciate Brother and Sister Strong for the opportunity that we have to be able to come and be with you folks. And I was telling Brother Strong, I used to think about what Brother Briars, he used to boost about how great North Carolina is because of the Wright brothers. And as I was on the way down, I seen a sign that says Eden. And I told my wife, I said, well, we must be in the Garden of Eden now. So we're here in the great state of North Carolina. Amen. And so we're privileged to be here. I'm so thankful for this opportunity and just thankful for what God is wanting to do in our lives. As I have been preparing for this convention, the Lord has given me some things, and as I was just kind of going back over it in my mind, you know how it is, if you've ever been a preacher at all, you always wonder why this message, or why at this time, or something like that, but it seems that throughout this service, the Lord has confirmed what He has given me in my spirit, and I'm thankful for what the Lord is doing. But I'd like to just start off by reading some scriptures that I think that you are very familiar with. One of them is found in the Song of Solomon, the 6th chapter and the 10th verse. The Song of Solomon, the 6th chapter and the 10th verse. The Bible says, "Who is she that looketh forth as the morning? Fair as the moon, clear as the sun, terrible as an army with banners." Go with me to Mark, the 3rd chapter, if you would. Mark, the 3rd chapter. I'd like to begin there and read the 13th through the 15th verse. The Bible says, "And he goeth up into a mountain, and called unto him whom he would, and they came unto him. And he ordained 12 that they should be with him, that he might send them forth to preach, and to have power to heal sicknesses, and to cast out devils." Go with me to Mark, the 16th chapter. I'm sorry. Yes, 16th chapter. I'd like to begin there at the 15th verse. I need to read these so you'll see where we're going with this. "And he said unto them, Go ye into all the world, and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. But he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover." I'd like to read one more, and I believe it's Matthew, the 16th chapter. I'd like to just read the 18th verse of that chapter, Matthew 16 and 18. "And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Hallelujah. I'm Most of you have heard these scriptures preached over the years. Would you say amen?
Amen.
There's something special about knowing that God has chosen you to be a part of what is called the body of Christ. And of course, I probably can look around and I know that the majority of you that are here today are a part of the ministry in some aspect, whether it's pastoring or teaching or whatever. Maybe it's even a singing ministry, but you're a part of the ministry that God has placed you in. And so as I was thinking about the message for Ministers Convention, you know, sometimes when we pastors or ministers stand behind the pulpit, most of the time people think we have it all together.
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
That everything is going our direction. Mm-hmm. Everything is hunky dory, whatever that means. Somebody says, "How are you doing, Brother Cox?" I'm fine and dandy and sweet as candy. Most time we'll say, "I'm doing pretty good." My daddy would say, "Leave the pretty part off." But as ministers, sometimes we are faced with something that is constantly battling against us. And I thought about these scriptures, the Song of Solomon, terrible as an army with banner. Now, that you know, you could use that word terrible in the sense of, man, you're just terrible. You know, it's like somebody up playing music and they say, "Well, how did I do?" And you just really want to be honest and say, "That was bad." You know, that was bad. You would use the word terrible sometimes, But the Song of Solomon was not describing an army that was falling apart, but it was describing an army that was awesome. Jesus said that upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Jesus called unto him whom he would, and he ordained 12 that they should be with him so that they would have power to heal sicknesses and cast out devils. Then he said to go and preach and cast out devils, heal the sick. And this is the part that we really don't like to practice, but take up serpents. I like that part where it says, "And they shall, so I'll let them do it." Amen. I remember when we lived in Manor, Georgia. If you don't know where that's at, it's a little place outside of Waycross, and they used to have a caution light there, but now they have not even a caution light there. And so as I was going through there a couple weeks ago, I asked my dad, I said, "Where's the caution light?" He says, "I don't know, but I guess they'll put it back up. But if you go through there too fast, you'll miss it." And that area was, you know, it's kind of a swampy area. And so when we first moved down there many years ago to pastor, there was a lot of snakes there. And my wife would kill just about every snake she saw, even if it was a good snake. Somebody says there's not a good live snake. There are only good dead snakes. I described to her that there are some snakes that are good for us. They take care of killing those bad snakes or eating things that we don't like running around in the yard. But we don't like that part of the scripture, but it does say that they shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. So when I read these scriptures, I think of a dynamic, power-packed people of God.
Amen.
Amen? And so as I was studying this, I think about a man that was called of God. One of the 12 that was chosen to be with Jesus. He was a man that was real quick about speaking up when he felt like speaking up. You ever met somebody like that? I mean, they're ready to fight too. You know what I'm talking about? I remember the first time I met Brother Ard. And I was listening to him preach, and I thought, man, he reminds me of Peter a lot right there. But think about this for just a moment. This is Minister's Convention, and this is for us. Think about Peter for a moment. When Jesus was talking about him going to the cross and many would walk away from him, Peter was quick to say, Lord, everybody else may deny you, but not me. Somewhere we find, let's just read the scripture in Luke, the 22nd chapter. Luke 22 and begin there at the 31st verse. And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan hath desired to have you that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. And when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren. Now, I want you to get this tonight because of... I wrote a letter to our region the other day because of... you know, we were getting so many phone calls and prayer requests. And I was trying to encourage the church to rise up and be the church of God. And because of it seems like, and I don't know how it is here in North Carolina, but just being in this service and hearing and seeing what God's trying to do among us, it seems like that Satan is about his business. Amen? We're seeing all kinds of sicknesses and diseases. We're hearing... people that once had the victory, they're seeming to go through battles right now, and there just doesn't seem like they have the victory like they once had. Well, Jesus says to Simon, who had the revelation that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, here Peter has a vision because Jesus says to Peter, flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. So evidently Peter had a good relationship with the Father.
All right. Yeah.
But now Jesus is saying to Peter, Peter, Satan desires to have you that he may sift you. I wish that I could really describe what it really means to be sifted. But if you're a farmer, you know what the process of sifting is. It's a process of separating that which is good from that which is bad. Amen? And so we know that they would have those threshing floors, and they would somehow put things there that would run over the material somehow and crush it up, and then they would take a tool that would throw the stuff in the air, and the wind would move the shaft and all that stuff away from the true wheat. Now, kind of reminds me of Matthew 5, where Jesus said, blessed is the man, or blessed are they that, blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Now, you've got to understand, Peter was a man that was ready to fight.
He was ready to go.
But Jesus says, Peter, the devil desires to have you. But I have prayed for thee that your faith fell not. Now, let's kind of go on a little farther. And what we find is Jesus has been taken. He is ushered into an illegal trial. But Peter is following afar off. And at some point, somebody says to Peter, you're one of his.
Oh, no, I'm not.
Somebody says, you're one of his. Peter says, oh, no, I'm not. Somebody says, Peter, you're one of his.
The Bible says that Peter even cursed to prove that he was not one of his.
You see, again, some people look at us pastors and ministers and they say, man, they've got it together. But Sister Perkins, they don't know how many times we've been in the bedrooms or in the closet somewhere seeking the face of God to help us through the battle we're going through. Amen. And so here, I don't know what it was like, but I just kind of wonder when Peter heard the cock crow after he denied the third time. I just kind of wonder what came upon him.
Now he could have went and done what Judas did. He could have. But he wept.
I just kind of wonder what kind of weight was on him at that time. How many's ever been to a chiropractor? Anybody? You ever seen some of the I've been in those chiropractors at times where and when you're sitting out there in the weight room and somebody's going, oi! Oi! And you're thinking all the time, do I want to go back there? But the reason why people have to go to a chiropractor is because of the body gets out of alignment. And when the body gets out of alignment, it can't walk right. Doesn't have the power that it normally has because of it's out of proportion and it just can't operate the way that it should. And so the devil, he knows where to hit us at, knows what to throw at us, and he knows how to try to get us down. But Jesus said to Peter, Simon, Peter, the devil desires to sift thee as wheat, but I have prayed for you.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
You see, if I were to ask you this question, if I were to say, how many of you has ever been hurt? The majority of you would probably say, yes, I have. I remember when I was pastoring the first church, I was 24 years old. And man, I had this person to cut me to the core. But I found myself in an altar to pray. You see, even without that person apologizing to me, I got in alignment with the Lord. I could walk in victory without that person apologizing to me. Because I was in perfect alignment with God. And so what I see in these scriptures as I was studying this, I see in one place that God describes a mighty army as the church of God. Can you imagine? Can you imagine what would happen in our world today if the church of God was operating by the scriptures? They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. They shall just speak with
such power that demons tremble. Amen. And so here Peter, a bold man, one that was ready to fight when the battle got hot, but yet Satan was going to try to sift him and destroy him. But when you study that, what you can imagine is every time Peter would hit the ground, Satan would have that old fork and just throw him back up. Throw him back up. Throw him back up. So that every time he tried to look straight, he couldn't see straight. Every time he thought things was about to improve, they would get worse. And so the devil was trying to sift him because of Satan. Listen, Satan knew what Peter could become. Satan knows what you and I could become. Amen. So what he's trying to do is to keep us from becoming that. Come on and help me. Satan wants to keep us from becoming what God has created us to be. Huh? Now, Jesus said, I have prayed for you that your faith fail not. Now, some people would say that Peter's faith failed him. He denied the Lord 3 times. Surely his faith failed him. Someone recently said that Jesus was the biggest failure in the New Testament. They actually said that. They're a little crazy, but they actually said that. But you see, when Jesus said, I pray for you that your faith fail not, you see, by our responding to the Word of God is what actually changes where we're going to go. We could forget the Lord praying for us. And let me say, there are people that I can call, and I would trust that they would pray for me, and I trust that their prayers is going to be heard. But what better person to have praying for us than the one that is sitting on the right hand of the Father, making intercessions for us? You see, we can give in to our defeats because we have failed, but let me tell you something. I'm not walking in my own faith. Did not Paul say it is no longer I that lives, but it's Christ that lives in me? The faith that I live in is the faith of the Son of God. Hallelujah to God. So here it is. Yes, Peter denied the Lord. But I pray for you, Peter, that your faith fail not. I can just imagine old Satan probably just, I don't know, maybe it was just one of his demons. Maybe. He walks over to Satan and says, boy, I've done my job. Did you hear Peter deny the Lord 3 times? Satan says, oh yeah, I heard it. You did a good job. You did a good job. But all of a sudden, on the day of Pentecost, they were 120 in the upper room. And Peter was a part of that number. And all of a sudden, the sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind filled the house where they were sitting. And they began to speak with other tongues. That new tongues that he said they would speak with new tongues. Now they've got it. You see, Peter understands now that poor in spirit was not talking about just a flock. He was talking, the Lord was saying, you know what, if you'll get poor in your spirit, you'll get rich in my spirit. You'll find that there's a difference. Amen. Amen. And so here, all of a sudden, it's not John. It's not James. It's not Bartholomew. It's not one of those other disciples. But Peter stands up on the day of Pentecost and he begins to say, I want to tell you what you hear. It's not what you think. We're not drunk as you suppose. But this is that which was spoken of in the book of Joel. Hallelujah. Where he said, in the last days I'll pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And he began to preach a powerful message. And 3,000 were added to the church. Who said Peter was a failure? Amen. Satan thought he was. Can you imagine old Satan looking over to that old demon? I thought you defeated him. Well, I thought I did too. Well, what in the world's the matter with you? Get out of here and go to work. 3,000 added to the church. You think Satan just backed off? Oh no. But let me tell you, a little while longer, Peter and John's going up to the hour of prayer. Hallelujah. And there was a man lame at the gate. Peter said, silver and gold have I none. Wait a minute. Silver and gold have I none but such as I have. So evidently he's got something now. Hallelujah. I might have been sifted a little bit. I might have been whipped a little bit. I might have been put down a little bit. I might have denied the Lord. But I've got it back right with God. Hallelujah. Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have. Hallelujah. Give I unto thee in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Rise up and walk. And he took him by the hand and lifted him. And his feet and ankle bones received strength. He began to leap and praise God. Do you know why? Because the one that Satan tried to destroy him, Satan desired to have him. That's what the scripture says. Satan desires to have you. Satan desires to have you. You think you're going through a battle without the one up there knowing about it? Even as he said to Peter, but I have prayed for you. Even the Spirit, according to the Word of God, prays with groanings that cannot be uttered. When we do not know what to pray for, he knows what to pray for. Amen. And so I'm saying to you, Church of God, yes, the Scriptures describes an army that is magnificent, that is powerful, that is glorious. But I want to tell you something. You know, there's some things that's going on right now where people are Satan is desiring to have them and trying to sift them that is weak. But here's a prayer that's going on up in heaven. Jesus is praying to the Father. Father, that's one of mine. That's one of I shed my blood for them. That's one of mine. Hallelujah. And let me tell you, his prayer works. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You say, well, how do you know that it works? I'm here because of God's miraculous power. I can tell you about my family. I can tell you that at one point in my family, when I was very young, somewhere around the age of 15, my mom and dad was at the verge of divorce. I remember standing in the living room with my mom, and my mom and dad was backslidden. I said, Mom, give your heart to Jesus. And she would not hear me because of she had been hurt so bad. And so I remember being a Sunday school at such a young age, 15 and 16 years old. Remember the small little class probably would fit in this area right here. Had four or five or six in there teaching, and you had to come through my Sunday school class to get into the sanctuary. I remember that Sunday that I was standing there teaching the Word of God, getting ready to take the offering into the sanctuary to give to the secretary. And that door swung open. I remember the man that was standing there was my dad. He walked through my Sunday school, went into the sanctuary, and all of a sudden I heard a roar from heaven. Hallelujah. And I said, wait just a minute. I'm going to take the offering with me. I went in there. The first thing I did was look toward the altar, and there my dad was at the altar praying through to the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Some weeks later, we was in revival. My mom came in that revival. I just knew this is the night. This is the night. The Lord moved. My mom got up, walked out the door the same way she came in. But I didn't give up. Because I know whom I believe in. Next night, the Holy Ghost got to moving. My mom, sitting on the third pew, got up to where from where she was at, came to the altar of prayer, gave her heart to the Lord. After that, my sister came to the Lord. My brother came to the Lord. My all of my family started filtering in to the church there. Why? Because of all of the heaven heard somebody's prayer. I'm here to tell you, my friend, we cannot go the way that God wants us to go until we get what we need before we go. Amen. You see, you can stand up behind the pulpit. You see, we got this memorized. Amen. We got it memorized. We know exactly how to run a service. Sometimes we know exactly how to ruin a service. Amen. We've got it programmed so well. I told Brother Strong that sometimes we have studied so much that we've studied God right out of the message. Come on and help us. You see, we know how to do things. We know how to sing our songs. We know how to take up an offering and when to take up an offering. We know how to begin the service and all that. But I remember a time when the power of God did not wait until the first person got up to sing. The glory of God began to move in the service. Hallelujah. And demons they weren't able to sit on the pew. Amen. I remember being in a service one time. I was asked to lead the Saint Song service. I remember standing there and asking everyone to stand. This woman sitting here on the very front, she just did this number. And a very, very uncomfortable feeling came over me. And I knew this person. I'd heard that she just got saved. And so I just kind of played off, you know, that feeling because of, you know, she just got saved. But I knew that there was a presence in that service that was not from God. The Holy Ghost began to move, and that demon began to act up. Come to find out, That woman went to a church around the corner, run every member out of the building. Every member out of the building. Her husband went up to the pastor, said, "Take my name off of this roll. I don't want to be a part of a church that's afraid of the devil." I'm telling you, saints of God, we're not to be afraid of the devil. Amen. We need to get to the place that whatever has come against us, whatever has been offending us or hurting us or trying to pull us down, I'm here to tell you it's time to recognize that there's one that is praying for us. Hallelujah. And his prayer, hallelujah, is saying that your faith fail not. Hallelujah. During that service, one of the things that really bothered me was as that demon was mocking the Holy Ghost, the pastor was leaning up against the building, and somebody said, "Somebody needs to take her to a psychological place or some place that deals with mental problems." And I'm like, "Do you not feel what I'm feeling? Do you not see what I'm seeing?" You see, the devil can hide and make us feel like that's all it is. You see, in our world today, there's so much sickness, and all we want to do is medicate. Don't you misunderstand me. I'm not preaching against going to doctors. I'm not saying that. But I'm telling you, there's something wrong when we have medicated everything. But a demon goes acting up, throwing some more medicine. Somebody needs to get a hold of God and say, "Lord, I'm tired of being wounded. I'm tired of being hurt. Oh God, help me to rise." you got to go. Now, here's something I want to leave with you tonight. Think about this for just a moment. We believe this Bible is the Word of God. We took a covenant to believe and practice its teachings. Amen?
Amen.
That we would take this Bible as the Word of God. In this book, this Bible, it says that the latter house, that the latter house shall be greater than the former. Now, church, I can stand before you today and I can tell you about the early 70s and the 80s, and I can tell you about eyes being opened. I've seen two people in my life raised from the dead. Amen. Seen it with my own eyes. Seen people come in wheelchairs, and when the service was over, the wheelchair was laid in the yard and the person that came in it was walking around. Seen a man was deaf in his ears. Seen him healed in one service. I seen it with my own eyes. So I would say that was some glorious times. That was some glorious times. But the scripture says the latter house. Now, where are we at? Are we the former? Or are we the latter? We're the latter. The latter house shall be greater than the former. Now, the devil knows that. Why do you think there's so many problems in the church? I'm hurting here. I'm hurting there. I can't do what I used to do. Members that odd with one another. We don't have to worry about the attacks from the outside. Because the devil's got us so stirred up because we're not in line with the Spirit of God the way we need to be, that every little thing offends us. Oh, that offends me. I ain't going to go back to church. My church at Roanoke, where I pastor at, they tell me that they had a pastor, and you'd probably know his name if I could call it, but they tell me that one time, if you got up to go to the bathroom while he was preaching, he would say, "Sit back down." And they was talking about, boy, what a great man of God he was. And I asked him, I said, "Now, would you appreciate me doing that to you today?" "Oh, no." I tell you, if I did that, they'd pull out their stones. Amen. We want some bold preaching as long as it's not toward me. Preacher hurt my feelings today. Like one man told his wife, "I'm not going back to church. That preacher would point his finger at me while he was preaching." Nowadays, you have to do it this way. Do you know why? Because, listen, every one of us in this building must recognize that we're going through a battle. We're going through some battles. Satan desires to sift us as wheat. We're being sifted. I want to tell you tonight, get a hold of God's unchanging hand. You see, when Mary and Martha came to Jesus, one of the questions that Jesus said was, "You believe that Lazarus rise again?" "Oh yeah, Lord. On the resurrection, we believe, yeah, Lord." Jesus said, "I am. I am. That I am was the I am before Abraham. I am the resurrection and life." You see, We believe certain things. Can I just say this? I remember some of those old prayer warriors. They'd grab your head. In the name of Jesus, be healed. Now it's like this. Lord, if it's your will. If it's your will, Lord. Because, Lord, if we pray to heal him and he doesn't get healed, then, Lord, I don't want to be embarrassed. The scripture says that he would send them forth and have power over sicknesses. And this is what's been hitting me here lately. Can I be honest with you? This is what's been hitting me lately. And they shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. And these signs shall follow them that believe. I was riding with Brother Horton the other day, and I said, Brother Horton, I said, this scripture is eating me up, because I feel like I believe. But I question, Lord, do I believe? Are you there? Are you there? You see, you know what has happened? We have taken what used to work in the church and we have made it a formula, and that formula is only a form that we go through because it worked for them. But that formula is not working for us today. Why? Because of the scientists that made the formula. All those that entered into that room, that throne room with the creator of the formula. Got a relationship with the creator of the formula. And they went out and practiced it. So I say, God, help us as the church of God to get to know the one that created the formula to a point that it's no longer a form, but it is a practice. Will you stand with me? I asked Sister Kim to find a picture of a mighty military man. Have you got one yet? Why isn't he up fighting? Why isn't he up shooting somebody? I didn't know she was going to choose this, but somewhere we've got to get back on our knees. You know what I told my local church? I told my local church when I die, and I'm laying in the casket, I hope the devil shows up just to make sure I'm dead. I want to be so full of God that that's how scared he is of me. When we open our eyes in the morning and our feet hit the ground, Satan should start trembling in that moment. Hey, better wake up. So-and-so just got up out of bed. He's fixing to go to prayer. I don't want to just say Jesus as a form. I don't want to just say Jesus because I heard somebody else use that name. Because you know the story of the sons of Stephen. Paul I know and Jesus I know of who he is. I want to be so full of God. Listen, listen, and I'm saying this to be true. I can see brothers back there, and I can see a shadow coming across that aisle. Can you imagine being so full of God that whenever somebody walked by you being sick? Hallelujah. You didn't have to touch them. You didn't have to say one word. You didn't have to say glory to God and hallelujah. But just being so full of God that just the shadow of Peter walking by, they were healed. Or what about brother Strong, what would you do if somebody walked up to you and said, brother, let me have that coat? Because of the anointing is on you so strong, I want to wear that coat for a minute. The Bible says that handkerchiefs and aprons were taken from the body of Paul. People were healed and delivered. The glory of the latter happens. Shall be greater than the former. I want to be profitable for the work of the Lord in this hour. In this hour. You know what? I would have loved to met Paul the Apostle. I would have loved it. I'd love to know John and James and Peter. But God didn't choose me to live in that hour. God chose me to be here now. Now, can I close this way? You can either let your battle get you down to a point that you're not useful, or you can let that battle be a stepping stone to becoming that individual that God has called you to be. What's it going to be? It's your decision. The price is right. Your name has been called. What are you going to do? There's a song that says, I'll stand for Jesus and let the world go by. Let's stand for Jesus. Can we pray together? Maybe you want to come to this altar and pray because of God has spoken to your heart. I'll be the first to say, I want more prayer. I want to seek God. Would you do that? Would you come right now? Let us seek the Lord together. If you want to kneel where you're at, let's pray together. Let's talk to the Lord. God, help us. God, help us.